Cor blimey, don't you knock before entering? Hi guys, welcome to another ad hoc stream where anything could happen. Well, primarily, I happen, but yeah, that's another story. Hi Gatwick man, hi Specs. I don't even see that you're watching. Try the wine. Oh, it's saying zero watching, but I don't know how many of you saw the opening before I hit the thing. Who knows? It'll be there in the playback. Hi, folks. Cool, blimey, everyone's jumping on suddenly this evening. Wow. Normally it's a few minutes before anyone actually wakes up and notices that I'm broadcasting, but oh well. Hi, good evening, and this is an update and all sorts of crap is going on. The wine glass has a bit of a story behind it. Well, it's a 10-year-old story, but this particular glass is one that I had to resource for various reasons. As you can see, dragon and all the rest of that stuff. A very nice pewter glass, and I managed to track one down on Fleabay after many years. And this is a nice red wine that a friend gave me. Yeah, they know their wine, and my tastes don't necessarily match up to theirs, but can't drink too much because I'm driving tomorrow, but hey-ho. One of the reasons for getting this particular glass is because Mum wants a picture, to replace a picture. So what I'm going to have to do is, upcoming in the few months ahead, many months ahead, is I'm going to be doing a photography project with this glass. So yeah, when that'll be, God knows, because other things are going on. Yeah, where do I start? I'll start by flipping you to the web for a minute, and I'm hoping that this is going to be the right one. Yep, that is a Walkman. It's the HS-PX303. With me, everything is a long story. And this is another one of those long stories. I had one of these many years ago. As you can probably see by the year was 1989, and they weren't around for too many years after that. When I was in Sheffield, facing pretty much the decision of when to change, if to change, and all the rest of that, I spent quite some time out walking the streets of Sheffield. And the music kept me company, and I was burgled, and yeah, it was taken away, it was stolen. I mean, all my hi-fi equipment got stolen, but pretty much recorded him. He got 100 hours community service, and we got most of the hi-fi back, but he'd fenced the Iowa before the police could catch up with him. Which was, yeah. In the intervening years, I was too poor and scratching a living, so I couldn't get another one. But and to be honest, recovering from that was, I wasn't even thinking about it at the time. But for a number of years now, I've been stepping up the search for one of these HSPX 303 units. And, well, yeah, that's the unit that I'm looking for. And how long have I been doing YouTube for? Nearly 9 years. 9 years, possibly 10. If you look up the profile, it'll probably tell you. I don't keep track of those things. But yeah, you got notified about it? KDE Connect, or should it be Connect? Where are you finding KDE Connect? Pass. Good evening, Paul, Specs, Scout McMahon, hi everyone, and yeah. So anyway, back to the story at hand. Yeah, something happened in my search. I stepped up the search because, you know, as time goes on, I've been, you know, they very rarely pop up on eBay, and by the time I find out that they're on eBay, they've typically come and gone. So I've stepped up the search. Wrong time to step up the search, really, because of all the financial issues around December, especially with the bathroom, yike. And A few things popped up. There's been a guy that I've been chasing for about a year or two, because he's got more than one of these. But anyway, joined 3rd of December 2008. My God, it'll be 10 years. 10 years next year. Wow. Yeah. Anyway, yeah, so a few things happened, and I've ended up with, I've missed out on a few of them just by smidges, and stuff's happened, and next year I hope to be bringing you a few other bits and pieces. This is a HSP505. It's not an X505, but it is one that is in need of some TLC. One of the classic reports on this is that the volume on one channel is dying. And I've been putting bits and pieces together in the last few weeks before anything happened. This is a spare belt for a 303 when I finally get one. We have a 3000 Hertz tape. Calibration tape. I've been getting hold of some SA90s. TDK SA90s chrome type 2 have been my weapon of choice since 30 odd years ago. And yeah, tried to get some metal tapes, but they're a fortune, absolute fortune, because they were dyed years ago. Anyway, I think I've managed to get three Sony SA, no, not SA, they're a different different brand, different mark. Anyway, we also got some of these, which, as you can see, I hope, are, no, you can't, because this is a crappy camera, is they are lead acid batteries, and they're stick batteries. They're called gum stick batteries, and they go inside the tape unit. So of the picture that you can actually see there, the tape occupies about half of that. All the electronics and mechanics are behind it, and including the battery, which is pretty impressive. However, there's always a but. This is retro equipment, and as anyone knows, with retro equipment, if you're gonna make use of it, you've got to be able to repair it. And to which a load of stuff had just popped up, including this one, which is a list of Iowa capacitor replacement guide, which is on a forum and has all sorts of different capacitors for the common ones. It's going to be very difficult finding the capacitors and very other bits and pieces that are going to be needed, because got to basically repair these and bring them up to scratch. And also on the Stereo To Go forum, there's a list of common Walkman capacitors, 2017 update. 2 degree, I'm doing this completely ass backwards. I haven't really learnt enough about electronics, but by the time I've actually learnt enough about electronics, this stuff will be even rarer than it is now. So I've got to do something. I mean, fortunately, I've got some friends managing to find and salvage the service manuals. This is for the HSPX505, also known as the HSPX50. So actually the HSPX303 is known in Japan as the HSPX30. So that actually widens the search area, because there's more model numbers that I can actually search for. And here, yeah, that I've managed to find is, no, that's the JX303. Where's the other one? I must have printed another one, because there must be another. That's the 505. That's the 303. No, it's not the HX, the PX303. It's the, yeah. So what did I do with that then? Right, gotta find that, because basically I've got the manual somewhere, the service manuals, the service manual for my main cassette deck, because I can't actually trust. Did I actually manage to merge the whole damn thing into one of these? Oh boy. Yeah. No. Gotta find out where the hell I've put that, what I've done with it. But ultimately, I'm even going, because my own Technics hasn't been calibrated, I'm going to have to calibrate it and maintain it and bring that up to snuff as well. It's an awful lot. So at the start of 2018, you can expect more electronics from this channel. I'm going to have to use the kits and get used to doing the small surface mount components. And then I'm going to have to do the kits, and then I'm going to get working on some of these. On this, indeed. The key thing is going to be finding the capacitors, hence the service manuals. I'm going to have a quick check in a location, see if I can find it. No, can't find it, so God knows where that is then. Technics RSB605, I think. I've got the PDF, so I can print it off again with that massive gigantuan printer that ended up being here. So yes, the long-term goal is still to get the PX303. So yeah, that's what's going to be coming up. But there's 15 items still outstanding on the eBay thing, so those have yet to arrive. And it's possibly going to be a little in January before I've got everything together to be able to start on this stuff. That's how it all goes. Other updates, I managed to get this, which was Jeff Wayne's musical version of War of the Worlds, Oola Dooboola, the remix album. Now, it just so happened that I was coming across this remix album, version 2, and reading the reviews, and people were saying how number 1 was better than number 2. So, me being me, I went ahead and got number 1. To be honest, there's only a couple of tracks on there that's really doing anything for me. A lot of the others are just not hitting my sort of taste, if you know. But some other stuff came up, and I have these. Royal Air Force, 100th anniversary, running cadences of the US Armed Forces, which covers a number of them, Marines, Air Force, Navy and Army, and also a remix of the running cadences for the Army Airborne. I come across some really odd stuff, you know. It's just one of those things that you wind up clicking on things. So in the links you will find all sorts of bits and pieces. Let's just change a few things here. And you'll find Don't Sit Under the Apple Tree. Now that track isn't actually on this one, but it gives you an idea for the kind of performance level that the bands are operating at. This actually has 5 bands on it. I don't know if you're going to be able to see that. Probably not. So it's the Central Band of the Royal Air Force, the Band of the Royal Air Force College, the Band of the Royal Air Force Regiment, the Royal Air Force Squadronaires, and the Royal Air Force Swing Wing. Try getting my lips around that when I've had too much to drink. Or in fact, not enough. Cheers. But anyway, some of these are the kind of hits that you'd hear from wartime Second World War period. And some of them are the more traditional band music that you would associate with the Air Force. So you've got all the traditional stuff in here. The Spitfire Prelude, the Royal Air Force March Past, 633 Squadron, all that kind of rousing music. The Oobla Doobla remix, I'll leave it up to you guys to actually work on that one. Next we have US Army Cadence. Now that's just one which is a demo really of the walking cadence, which is the most common thing that you hear if you're watching a film about the US Army, and you know, you get the usual thing in the background. But what really attracted me was the higher spec running cadences. What can I say? The remix was reasonable. Had a lot of high pace to it, but unfortunately, musical instruments were mixed in. But when you listen to a cadence, they didn't. It sounded like they didn't do the cadence specifically for the recording. It looks like the recordings were all done outside, and as you know, the pitch can vary. You know that the singing can go up and down, so it does in places go out of step with the instruments. But I think that was my favourite of them. This one, the cadences were of all different bits and pieces, and there's no music in with these. They are just the straightforward cadence as spoken. I'm getting my whims mixed up. Somewhat difficult to find. Not my favourite, but a few of the other tracks were in there. That one is typically smaller cadences. You know, I think the longest one is like 2:20, and a lot of them are about 1:30, and they're just simply cut where they would otherwise loop. And you know, the words are pretty predictable in that sort of thing. It's the rousing sort of, we are number one, we are army, we are airborne, yada yada, etc., etc. But this one, Marine Corps Corps running cadence with the lyrics, that one's pretty good. Low ride, low rally, lay ho. Yeah, that was pretty good. Moving on to language, and this is probably going to upset a few of my friends when they see it. For some time, one of the reasons why I didn't get involved with some of the, or stepped back from some of the debates that were being had was quite frankly because they weren't being debates, to be honest. But in the Great Debate Society, or the Great Debate full stop, was what was happening, is because a lot of people were not really there to debate, they were there to argue. And that's one of the things that stepped me back. But one of the things that has always fascinated me is language. I mean, one of my key go-to dictionary is one that my father had from the 1960s, a pocket Oxford. And I frequently, you know, in some of these discussion videos, you get someone from, you get people from different countries even. The problem is, you know, watching, I don't think that I've ever really watched any of the videos when the people have actually set down a common standard. as you'll know, let's say, for example, you've got someone from the UK and someone from the US discussing the socially acceptable length of pants. Of course, in the UK, pants are trousers, the outer pants, and in the UK, pants are the underwear. So you could have the British person answering that the longest pants should be ever is under the knees, is just below the knees, and should be shorter and end right up, and the usual pair of pants should be right up tight at the top of the legs. And obviously that would probably upset the American person, who thinks that pants should be a reasonable length, you know, and you can see how things can go bonkers. But so what I do, because I know that especially being dyslexic, grabbing hold of the meanings of words is quite important. And I'll frequently go to the dictionary because there's a lot of words that I just think that I know but I don't know. And one of the other things, which you'll see in a minute, is how words can be defined one way, but the actual definition of how the word is used can change over time in society. That's one thing that dictionaries should actually keep track of, but there you go. And a few other, so here we've got Discover the Story of English. What was it? So you have the OED, the Oxford English Dictionary, which is typically what I run from. And I thought, okay, let's get a copy of the English dictionary. How bad can it be? Because I've got a pocket, and I've seen a concise. The full Oxford English Dictionary at the moment is a 20 volume print edition, which will set you back a cool £846.41. Unsurprisingly, UK delivery is free. It better bloody had be at that price. Morning, DTEC 30. How the devil are you? How is everyone, by the way? Cheers. So, yeah. Jay Simpson is the author. I think probably primary author, because there's been God knows how many authors of the dictionary over the years, and multiple authors at the same time. But there you go. God knows how many tens of thousands of words and definitions. So yeah, if you want the ultimate reference work for English, yeah. at least, there you go. It's going to set you back a fair chunk of cash. There's other things around here. You can also get it published on a CD-ROM. Version 4, which is now Mac compatible with a Pentium 4 1.6 GHz processor for a dictionary. What? And there's all sorts of other bits and pieces in the links. Yeah, leading up to Christmas. Is anyone really okay leading up to Christmas? But there's a whole lot of other bits and pieces, including how long does it take to read every word in the dictionary, which came out at... That's according to Christian Saunders, founder of Kanguro English, who, along with a team of trusty volunteers, took on the Herculean task of reading every single word in the Oxford Dictionary of English on live stream this World of Teachers Day to raise money for the education of refugees in Europe. Apparently it takes 41 hours of continuous reading. That must hurt the old voice bank. If you reading the final word, Zyrian, a language from northwest Russia, I think it's really interesting, but everybody involved said they actually enjoyed reading their reading their pages. Once you start reading, it's like a kind of meditation, and I think it activates something deep in our brains. I had such crazy dreams the night we finished. To borrow from I can't pronounce that properly. If you gaze long into a dictionary, the dictionary also gazes into you. Favorite word was slender loris. yeah. So reading up on that was pretty good. There was something else. Yeah, I had to read up on that one. Also, the Oxford comma is explained in there, as well as all sorts of bits and pieces. Where, how should the Oxford comma be used if you follow the Oxford comma? The Oxford comma being basically, you can see it down here. Normally, if you're going to put an and, if you've got a list of five things, and you put an and between four and five, you normally don't put a comma between item 4 and item 5. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. But the Oxford comma is 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Gee. Different people follow all sorts. Yeah, 41 hours. I have to admit I thought it would be longer than that. And one of those things popped into my mind. Which is one of the hottest debates, or used to be one of the hottest debates in the Great Debate Society, which is, are all babies atheists? So I decided to look up on the Oxford Dictionary the definition of atheist, and whichever side of the debate you're on, if you have an argument on this, don't argue with me, argue with the Oxford Dictionary, yeah? Definition of atheist in English: a person who disbelieves or lacks belief in the existence of God or gods. So a person who disbelieves is someone who has an active lack of belief and has an active position, or lacks belief simply means, as far as I'm concerned, that they don't have one. Now, you could actually go further than this. You could actually try and track down lax belief, which is... I've actually got to look this up on another page because I've got so many blocking things on this that it's unreal. How am I going to get Chrome? Oh, it's going to pop up there. OxfordEnglishDictionaries.com. And we're going to look up lack. The state of being without or not having enough of something. There is no lack of entertainment aboard ship. The case was dismissed for lack of evidence. There is a lack of parking space in the town. The state of being without. So, you could say that this is the state of being without belief in the existence of God or gods. So, if you took it through that definition, then you could say, theoretically, that according to the definitions in Oxford dictionaries, that all babies are atheists because they are in a state of being without belief. I'm going to get some very nasty comments in the comment section of this video. I can see it coming off. Yeah, like I said, if you've got an argument with that one, argue it with Oxford, not me. Anyway, we're now going to go on to the general side of all this, which is politicians lack spine. Yeah. This was an interesting one for me. A robot giant FX2 is ridden by human pilots. What was it, Pacific Rim and Mech Warriors and all that sort of stuff? This is really the... hi, Edmund. No problem. These happen when they happen. There's no need to apologize. They just happen. Yeah, a robot giant FX2 ridden by human pilots. So that link is in the hoo-ha bar. I think that is link number one. You got one link on its own, a block of links on the music, a block of links on the Oxford English Dictionary, and this is the first link in the next block. So you can watch that by yourself. Obviously, I can't play these things here. Copyright and all that jazz. But that's pretty cool. I thought that was a pretty good thing to watch. Yeah, a robot giant FX2 ridden by human pilots. They said that the worst of it was actually keeping the stability, and their primary goal is for like people who can't move themselves. Sort of, I suppose you could say that it would be the next the next advancement, potentially from wheelchairs, potentially. But yeah, we're going on with that thing. This is how we get death robots, people. Death robots. Actually, some of them have already been done. There was actually a two robot fight between a Japanese and an American robot. I think the American robot won. You'll probably have to look it up. But yeah. Busy with organizing getting married. Ooh, congratulations. Congratulations. Yeah, what month are you aiming for? Hadn't really thought about babies. Congrats. Yep. Already getting into robot cops now around the world. Yeah, if you can. The RoboCops that were actually pretty prim. There's an American mall which has got some robotic security guards, and one of them just ended up on its side in a pond somewhere. Oh, bloody funny. Yeah. Around Feb, March. Ooh, so it's going to be a bit chilly. I hope you have good weather. I hope you have good weather. Best of luck. Congratulations. Yeah. So, yeah. There we go. Robot giant FX2 ridden by human pilots. I thought that was just cool. Next one. market crashes, the tulip and bulb craze. Now, this is from the 1630s in the Netherlands, and the only reason that this really came on the radar is because of the Bitcoin issue. It hit, it broke $20,000 per Bitcoin, and then in the course of a week lost about 40% of its value, currently at about 12,000-ish. Yeah, but the long story short, being underwear too if it gets chilly. Yeah, of different lengths. Have the argument. yeah. Well, I remember, I was supposed to say this at the top. In the last chats, people wanted me to record about my personal transsexual journey, but I was thinking that it's quite a chunk, and it would be better if I could focus it down a bit more. So if you can be a bit more specific, and if you're not in the chat now, drop it in the comment section of this video, and then I can pick up more rather than go through the whole damn thing, because I've already got an 8 or 9 parter on that, and people do get a bit tired talking about it. Yes, the environment cost alone is crazy, and it's getting more expensive as the amount drops. But this was one of the interesting things that came out of it was the tulip and bulb craze in the 1630s, which was basically a speculative bubble. I don't know how many people are going to be able to read this. In 1593, tulips were bought from Turkey and introduced to the Dutch. The novelty of the new flower made it widely sought after and therefore fairly pricey. After a time, the tulips contracted a non-fatal virus known as mosaic, which didn't kill the tulip population but altered them, causing flames of colour to appear upon the petals. The colour patterns came in a wide variety, increasing the rarity of an already unique flower. Thus, tulips, which were already selling at a premium, began to rise in price according to how their virus alterations were valued or desired. Everyone began to deal in bulbs, essentially speculating on the tulip market, which was believed to have no limits. The true bulb buyers, the garden centres of the past, began to fill up inventories for the growing season, depleting the supply further and increasing the scarcity and demand. Soon, prices were rising so fast and high that people were trading their land, life savings, and anything else they could liquidate to get more tulip bulbs. Many Dutch persisted in believing they would sell their hoard to hapless and unenlightened foreigners, thereby reaping enormous profits. Somehow, the originally overpriced tulips enjoyed a 20-fold increase in value in 1 month. Yeah. And at the end of the day, some people right at the peak decided to sell and crystallize their profits. The values just smashed, and people lost their life savings, their property, and all sorts. There were a few people who benefited from it, and there were an awful lot who lost. Yeah. Went up 40% in 1 day because one of the owners sold his share. Bitcoin didn't break 20k but made a decent profit from the recent hike. Yeah, Edmund, 19k. What can you explain? What can you say? You know, you got to do what you got to do. Everything's a chance. I mean, what would happen if over the next week it went to over 22,000? Everything's a risk, and you've got to determine whether you want to get involved in that. Ah, explains how you're able to afford to get married. Makes a lot of sense. There was somebody else that did it. I mean, they'd been planning to get married for something like 20 years, and all of a sudden they won the lottery, which made them be able to afford the wedding, and it was finally happening. And of course, yeah, dealers refused to honor contracts. People began to realize they'd traded their homes for a piece of greenery. Panic and pandemonium were prevalent throughout the land. The government attempted to step in and halt the crash by offering to honour contracts at 10% of the face value, but then the market plunged even lower, making such restitution impossible. No one emerged unscathed from the crash. even the people who had locked in their profit by getting out early suffered under the following depression. Ah, right. So because the entirety of, even though they got their profit and got their money, because society effectively crashed, the money was worthless. I'm out of wine. I can't have any more because I'm driving tomorrow, not tonight. Yeah. So it was just interesting to see how these things happen. Another interesting thing. One of the other things which hit me was how an episode of Chopped Junior changed the way I parent. And the long story short is, this is the story of a mother. Mom, can I bake something? My 8-year-old daughter pleaded as she entered the kitchen. Of course she wanted to bake something, because I'd just spent the past 2 hours preparing, cooking, serving and cleaning up from a dinner where I made 6 different dishes to please our family of 5. I sighed. Not right now, sweetie. I just finished cleaning up and it'll be too much of a mess. But she then walked in on her daughter watching Chopped Junior. And what blew her mind away was how such young children were actually coping with some serious cooking tasks, as in all the preparation, the knife work, and their understanding of the foods and the flavours at that age. And she suddenly thought, whoa, maybe I better stop treating my child like a child. And I vowed right there and then that I would do an experiment. The next time and every time my daughter asked me to do something in the kitchen, I would say yes. Mom, can I bake cookies? Yes. Mom, can I make scrambled eggs? Yes. Mom, can I make mac and cheese? Yes. Mom, can I make a quetzilla? Yes. Mom, can I make homemade frosting? And in fact, I think there's something down here that she had to look up what a quesadilla is, because I don't even know how to pronounce it, let alone what it is myself. But it's interesting. If you get to what, there are some episodes of Chopped Junior on YouTube, and they were a very interesting watch. I mean, I have been involved with some TV companies, and some I've seen how some of this stuff works, and I get a sense of, this isn't quite fully maybe how it seems. Quesadilla, thank you. And train them young. Pity is they don't train them all the way through schooling so they have better life skills for later. Spoken to people made so few people know how to cook or teach cooking to their children. Yeah, but I think that the key thing here, and not only in cooking but generally, is that the children can achieve so much at a younger age, and we're just writing them off from being able to do what we think. Oh no, we don't want the child to be able to be handling sharp knives and all the rest of it. And you know, in reality, if they're showing enthusiasm for something, genuine enthusiasm, yeah, let them take those risks and adventure and go forward and learn things. And yeah, I'm just watching it looks like the thank you very much to Brian Specs, and I think it was Brian Specs that eventually helped me sort this out. Eventually, the text, we haven't got the chat that you're seeing on the side of the screen, which is over there. I've got to say over there because I can't reach long enough. My arm will reach over there, but you can't see it. it's the effort and the enthusiasm. Too many times we're trying to keep our kids safe and we're dampening their enthusiasm rather than letting them adventure and learn. And some of these kids are bloody good at what they're doing, and they know what they're saying when they're talking about some of these flavours and the various bits and pieces. You know, I can detect a bit of the production company behind it. But yeah. Back to the chat. The problem was, we'd love the fancier chat, but it's the browser. The Linux and Microsoft versions of OBS are coming with a certain browser version. But for Linux, we've actually got to get another browser, which is then going to be compiled, made, and brought in. When OBS are going to let Linux join the club, I don't know. But because of that browser, we're not able to interpret the CSS. And it's the CSS that makes the text do all the magic stuff that it does on other people's OBS overlay feeds. Yeah. Some of this stuff actually feeds into the transsexual side. And these days you have the youngsters are encouraged to do whatever they like. So you'll find girls in the woodwork and metalwork classes, and you'll find boys in with the home education and the cookery classes and the rest of that. But back in my day, more than 30 odd years ago, we were basically piled into those classes according to what we had between our legs, as opposed to our natural, what we naturally wanted to try and felt better at. So, one of the things is I am who I am, and the skills that I've got are pretty much the skills that I was taught. You don't have a lot of these skills like sewing or whatever because you're naturally good at them. You have those skills because basically it's what people drilled into you and taught you when you were young enough, because it's what they thought that you'd need. And I'll repeat the same thing that I said earlier on in the video. If you are one of the people who, basically in a previous chat, someone asked me to do a video on the personal transsexual side of it, and I'm asking for more definition, because I've already done an 8-part video on that and I don't want it to become a long video again. People get tired of these things. So if you want to put more, back then left was left, right was right. Yeah. Now we're hopping. Hopping mad. No, that was an off the cuff joke which I don't think quite worked, but anyway. So let me know, and either in the chat or more appropriately in the comments, because I want to get the video done, because I promised I'd get it done this month, and I want to know some sort of drill down, so I'm not making an overly long video about the transsexual side of things again. But oddly enough, that Iowa played its part in that story, which is why I'm attached to it and why I've been putting so much effort behind trying to find it. But yeah, that'll come. We go on to a slightly more serious subject, which is rape and abuse, the music industry's dark side exposed. This is an ongoing thing. The interesting thing is still what's going to come out of it. It was previously all the Hollywood side of things. It's now gone on to the music side of it. Even Tom Jones came forward and said that he'd been taken advantage of. It's one of the longer things to watch for how society changes. Now that people are talking about it, we've got a chance to change things. I think that for the majority part, the younger generations coming through are more inclined to equality and the less taking advantage, as was the sexism that was endemic in the times of Life on Mars, if you've seen that TV program. And I think that was one TV program which has started to enable these conversations to be had. It sort of uncovered um, Life on Mars did start this conversation ramping up, to my mind. That's when I started hearing more of it. Because the TV went... Life on Mars, basically, guy, a police officer, has an accident, knocked unconscious, and he sort of comes out as a police officer in the 70s, I think, and he encounters the 70s as it was. They don't sugarcoat anything, they paint it as it was, sexism and all. And that really, that's when I started to detect more, it detected people having those conversations more easily, and it's just escalated from there. And it's still been quite a few years coming, because I don't know when, how long was it ago. Wikipedia, I'm going to ask Wikipedia for Life on Mars. Life on Mars, UK TV series, broadcast on BBC One between January 2006 and April 2007. So it's been a long while coming. Hi Ben. There's been a few more bits and pieces in the chat. I'm going to have to catch up on that. So it's been a long time coming, and it has been ramping up. The interesting thing is what happens now. There was one minister's aide who was cleared of rape and is now calling for a return to anonymity of the accused. The accuser still has anonymity, and the accused used to have anonymity up until the 80s, I think. I think it was the 80s or the 90s. And then it was, so I think that's going to wind up being reversed. About 10 years. Left hand, right hand writing. Odd. Another good natured thing, though. The strangest things sent in the post. This tickled me. And Christmas, the busiest time of year. W. Reginald Bray, seen here being delivered to his somewhat bewildered father, claimed to be the first human letter to be sent by Royal Mail. Yeah. Apparently he was a bit of an eccentric who had all sorts of things sent. Ulysses by James Joyce was once determined obscene, and was fortified under Section 42 of the... Customs Censoriation Act 1876. So yeah, there was even that. The 1876 Act even predated the Obscene Publications Act of 1950 something. Yeah, it was bonkers. Some were actually being censored and stopped and failed to be delivered by things like this. L. Curzon, rotten old fool, House of Lords, and they refused to deliver it. Yeah, you've got to be, yeah. Yeah, weed. There has been actual complaints about from the post office staff that they can't legally open things, even though they know damn well, judging by the smell, etc., of the package, that there are drugs in it, and they're still duty bound to deliver it. And that one hit the press a couple of years ago. And believe it or not, in the post you can actually send what were they? They were rabbits. You could send game, I think. Yet objects you would think would not be allowed would be delivered, could be delivered by postmen, including living and dead creatures. Like today, food was commonly sent, but it was often unpackaged, because the rules stated game could be sent so long as it had a name label on the neck and would not leak. You gotta laugh at these things. And actually, live scorpions having to be examined by reckless postal staff after it was transferred to the returned mail office. Some suffragettes had themselves posted to 10 Downing Street so that they could get past the gate and deliver their message to the PM. And you can see there the two suffragettes and the post, the postman. But I think they ended up being returned because but a Downing Street official refused to sign for them, and the delivery boy had to return the women and explain to his bosses why he had failed to make the delivery. Interestingly enough, the U.S. Postal Service also has a history of transporting children in the post. I think if you look that up, you'll find them. Wow, you would be game to send rabbit. Let's have a look at this. U.S. Postal Service children. Yes, a brief history of children sent through the mail. Mailing children. It was made illegal in 1913. And there is a Boing Boing article, which I will, What happened? Yep, I wound up with two copies of the same thing. And, There's the Boing Boing article. Shipping children by postal mail illegal since 1913. And there you have, from the Smithsonian Flickr stream of historic public domain photos, a shot commemorating the end of being able to ship your children by postal mail. Can you believe it? No one ordered these women sent them back. Yeah, but there you go. If you just do a Google search, you'll find it easily, and there's quite a number of articles of shipping your, This city letter carrier posed for a humorous photograph with a young boy in his mailbag. After parcel post service was introduced in 1913, at least two children were sent by the service, with stamps attached to their clothing. The children rode with railway and city carriers to their destination. The Postmaster General quickly issued a regulation forbidding the sending of children in the mail after hearing of those examples. Yeah. And there was actually one guy who actually shipped himself by parcel to Australia. Let's see if I can find this one. Man, parcel, post, Australia. Australia post worker fired for throwing parcel over fence. I think he's done it more than once, if I can remember. Yeah. The man who posted himself to Australia, and it was on the BBC News. And, this is a couple of years old. In the mid-1960s, Australian athlete Reg Spears found himself stranded in London with no money to buy a plane ticket home. Desperate to get back to Australia in time for his daughter's birthday, he decided to post himself in a wooden crate. I just got in the thing and went. What was there to be frightened of? I'm not frightened of the dark, so I just sat there. So he designed this crate, which opens from the inside. Strapped himself in, got a blanket and water and whatnot. And that's how he did it. That's how they think he fitted into the case. And that's Reg Spears in London before his freight journey in 1964. Stunning. Absolutely stunning. Now, actually, what I've got to do is call this up and make sure that I've got various bits and pieces. I've got three tabs left, one of which is the Gemini Special. That's business, so I must have gone over the Gemini Special. I must have buggered that link up when I made that cocker. Yes, technology. We'll switch to technology very briefly. I wouldn't mind getting my hands on one of these just to see what it's like, but I certainly won't be spending any money on it, because my money's going elsewhere, as you probably saw at the start of this video. The Gemini, worth exclusive. Production begins in January on the first new computer form factor since the iPad, Planet Computing's modern Scion Gemini. It's already picked up an innovation award from the organisers of the International Consumer Electronics Show next month, where a formal launch will take place, and the project reached $1 million in crowdfunding this week. As the final pre-production prototypes tumbled off the plane from China this week, still warm, we popped round the Planet HQ to have a look. So there is the Gemini in its production case, which won't change. And yeah, there's various pictures and review. There's actually two pages on this, I think. It's going to be interesting. Me, personally, these days, I don't think I'm on the move enough to make use of it. I've got the netbook, effectively, in my backpack, which is carried all over the place. So, yeah. It comes preloaded with Google and Android and Linux, and it's interesting. You can, judging by the size of that person's hand and the cup of tea, you can roughly tell what kind of size this is. And it's interesting to see roughly that it is possible to actually type on the thing. Is there a price in here? Is there a price? So you can see some of the prototypes as they went through things. Fit and finish. There's also a few extra bits and pieces. Like you can see here, they've done some very interesting stuff in order to help support the screen. They've put in it's a three-pager, and they go onto the camera. Where's the cost? And how much is it going to set me back? The initial production run will be 3,000 units, still available at discount pricing for backers, which is $300 Wi-Fi only and $400 SIM and Wi-Fi, before it goes up to $500 and $600. So I don't know if you can actually make calls on it. I'd love to have one, but I haven't got the money for it. Other things are getting my money right now. So that may be hunt and peck typing. Well, actually, interestingly enough, I think the article itself looks like a laptop crossbred with a phone. That may be just exactly what it does turn out to be, if it can actually do the phone function as well, because they're saying it's got a SIM in it. Whether the SIM is data only, I don't know. But if you're interested in that kind of thing for that kind of price, it's worthwhile reading up on, I think. But yeah, in the article somewhere, I did think that they mentioned that it's possible. The Gemini agenda is designed around the fact that your fingers shouldn't be moving too far from the QWERTY. The same idea has informed the custom email client, very much a work in progress, which is a tweaked version of the open source K9 Android mail app. Here too, there are useful controls positioned along the bottom of the screen, and it will incorporate shortcut keys. So if I would, I think reading this as I did earlier today, I think it's going to be possible to touch type on this thing. Yeah, the GPD win range, but I think this is going to be a different layer of hardware on that one. More work critical, I think. Who knows? And I don't think the GPD came out with a mobile phone capable variant. So that's worth considering. If this is the kind of thing that piques your interest, look it up, because it looks interesting. I found an interesting one here. Can your online reputation be bleached? Now, this wasn't actually, may not be what you think it is, because it's actually on commercial efforts to stifle negative criticism. Now, I did sort of have a run-in with a company earlier this year, and basically I said they were thick as a brick, and they battled like hell to get the review taken off Amazon. And eventually I won, and Amazon reinstated the review the fifth or sixth time, and it stayed there. And after that, the company started chasing me down politely, and then they mentioned the word slander. they just thought that the thing could have been slanderous comment, and actually that only proved that they were as thick as a brick anyway, because slander is verbal. What's the written one? Not slander. Slander is verbal. There's another one which is written, but they're both a subcategory of defamation. And if it's if the comment is comes about from a result of genuine experience, then it's not defamation, because defamation, the definition is the deliberate telling of lies to hurt somebody's reputation or a business's reputation, saying something that isn't true with the deliberate goal of hurting their reputation. But because my comment was upheld because it was an official, but when she mentioned it, libel. Thank you, Brian. yeah, defamation is both libel. Libel is written, slander is verbal, and they're both defamation. But the minute they came at me and started saying those that was trigger word. Though that was a trigger word for me because of this, and it. Long story short is a company, if you leave a negative report, the companies will come after you and sue you. And even though you're in the right, you've still got to defend yourself in court, and that can pretty much bankrupt you. And as a result of that, people are taking down their negative comment because there's no way they can actually defend themselves. And that is how, you know... When you're reading up about the reputation of a company, treat it with a pinch of salt, you know, because you don't know how many people have either not put negative comment up there, or have taken their negative comment down because they've been threatened with legal action. Yeah, so basically I had that email, which they thought it was slander. And yeah, the truth is neither slander nor libel, it's the truth. But you've still got to defend yourself in court, which is still going to cost you money, you know? And it's all the hassle that's got to go in between. And if you haven't got the legal experience and you don't, you know, you don't spend much time around the legal enterprise, it scares the crap out of you. I know that I've been in a legal situation that I've lost. And if, at that time, I'd have been pushed for costs, I would have lost this house. That's how scary this crap gets, you know? And yeah, fortunately they decided to, it's that distinction between moral and legal, even though they were pretty much morally in the wrong, because the judge basically gave them hell for leather. They were legally in the right, so I lost, and I could have lost this house. I think that they determined that they were morally in the wrong, so they said, okay, let's be bygones, but if they'd pushed it, I would have really been in the crapper. And that's what basically did it with this as well. I don't think they are bogus. I don't know how many comments are bogus, DTEC. I don't know. Yeah, it's you've got to. I don't know that it's the onus is on them to make their case. That's become the scary part of some of this crap these days. It's strange. It used to be, and it's supposed to be, that you're innocent until proven guilty. But these days, it's just managed to turn around the other way. These days, I just don't know how the hell they've done it. But you've got to prove your own innocence. It's not enough for them to prove that you're guilty. You've got to prove your innocence. And if they've got the copy of the stuff that you actually put up on the website, you've got to prove that your comment wasn't libel, wasn't slander, but was the result of a genuine experience. And it's crazy. You just can't... It's just a stupid situation. What our society has become is absolutely scary. To be perfectly honest with you, it's bloody scary. Yeah, honest opinion, the product is very hard to counter. Yeah, but you got to prove that you purchased the product. And in my case, fortunately, because all this happened through Amazon, all the correspondence is there. And Amazon must have gone through the correspondence and backed me up and stopped them from putting another takedown against the comment. But when they came at me with that slander issue, I determined, oh fuck, and I took it down myself. And yeah, it's just the scary thing that these companies are coming at you, because I did do my research into the company, and the let's just say that that the person who heads it up has an interesting company history. Yeah. And one last news item is this one. The last of the iron lungs. You know, anti-vaxxers have been, it's been very vocal lately. And it's stunning. I believe that any anti-vaxxer should watch this. This is basically a man, Paul Alexander. He's one of the last few remaining polio survivors that are dependent on iron lungs. And it's a half a century old machine, and he's basically reliant on him. He's reliant on it to breathe, pretty much. I mean, he can get out of the machine for an hour or two at a time, but then he's got to work hard, and it's just heartbreaking. Couldn't move, couldn't walk, and just wasted away. Nevertheless, what he's done is absolutely stunning. He became he passed the bar, became a lawyer, and it's where is the section? He became polio is still a major concern in developing countries, and some of this is sodden religious based. Those idiot extremists stopping some of the polio vaccine from being administered. It's just disgusting. Where is it? He became. It shows how the epidemic, people panicked. Because the anti-vaxxers of today, do they actually know this? Have they actually ever experienced? Did they ever actually got any? Someone custom to bring his lung up to modern standards. Yeah. Do these people actually know what could happen? And some of these people should really talk with Paul Alexander, I think, and see what could happen to their child if they failed to really vaccinate against polio. And polio made a, the only thing that's protecting them against polio now is because it's confined to certain areas of the world, but it could very, very easily. I mean, if you were to not to be vaccinated, then grow up and then go on holiday to some of these parts of the world and you haven't been vaccinated, you could very well get it, I believe. I don't know if it's contagious at that age. It would probably take more. You're at risk. You've got to be at risk. He's been in this for his life, you know? He's been in that for his life. This guy himself is absolutely so inspirational in what he's done. In what he's done, you know, and when people have come to him for his services as a lawyer, you know, that they've seen the iron lung and he's explained it to them, and he said, nobody's turned him down. They've said, well, if he can put up with that, then he must be one hell of a lawyer. And yeah, what do you say? And yeah, they've managed to get a few other iron lungs and repair them. And this is the guy who's and they go through this. The biggest challenge was being the lack of the small parts. We're barely a generation past one of the country's most frightening epidemics, so close that some of its victims are still living in the archaic machines of that era. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I think it was the it's the age for the youth. The argument is they have to be done at that age because there's so many of them in very close proximity to each other in schools that if one of them gets something, it's going to be passed around like wildfire, pretty much. Yeah, herd immunity is one of the only things keeping us all safe. And there's been other food. I've missed a few other comments as well. Yeah, Edmund, perhaps you want to show them that video and what happens if not vaccinated against polio. You know, I'm not sure at what age polio would actually stop. Does it? I don't know. Polio age transmission. Infantile paralysis. The number of cases decreased dramatically following the vaccine in 1955. Travellers to countries where polio cases still occur should know they are immune or be fully immunized. In 2008, these areas include Africa, Southeast Asia, and the Eastern Mediterranean, and it spread when the stool of an infected person is introduced into the mouth of another person through contaminated water or food. Oral transmission by way of an infected person's saliva may account for some cases. When and for how long is a person able to spread polio? Patients are most infectious from 7 to 10 days before and after the onset of symptoms. However, patients are potentially contagious as long as the virus is present in the throat and feces. The virus persists in the throat for approximately 1 week after the onset of illness, and it's excreted for 3 to 6 weeks. So if what I'm reading is correct, then you could get it at any time of your life, really. If you come across someone or someone who's infectious. Scary. Very scary. But I wonder how many of these anti-vaxxers have not seen the impact, and would they really wish that sort of thing on their children? Would they really wish to expose their children to that kind of risk and that kind of life? And there's another one here. Martha Mason, woman who spent 61 years in iron lung. Yeah, that's going to be one to watch, but I'm not going to be able to do. Yeah. So, on that one, Exposure is the name of the game, yeah. Now that that's done, I think I'm going to close off in a few minutes if people have any other questions. I did actually fire up the machine and go into the Minecraft on the administrator account to see that it was working. And it's actually been up for... it was reporting nearly 10,000 days, 10,000 game days, which is about 3 months. That's a long time. So yeah, I'm hoping, I've only got 4 days off, which includes the weekend. So I'm hoping to get in to start those videos up. But yeah, it's still a case of collecting the various bits and pieces for the electronics and the Walkmans. I also, in January, I want to do the Xboxes, or at least get one of the Xboxes done and out of the way, because I've got to put that DVD player back together. Got to get that done. I also want to take a look inside one of these, which is the... this is the starter motor replacement unit for LED bulbs, and it feels lighter than the standard unit. In fact, can I get this apart now? I don't think I can. I'm going to need tools, I think, to crack it open. But it looks like there's possibly a capacitor in there, or a resistor. Don't know. Let's see if we can get this open. Can I get this open? Hello? Off the cuff electronics, just the way I like to do it. Got it. Oh, what the hell is that? Square capacitor? I don't know, there's no markings on it. Somebody will probably tell me exactly what this is. But that is what is inside the the starter motor replacement unit for an LED replacement strip light. And I haven't got my glasses here, have I? No, I haven't. Where the fuck are they? Oh, there they are. Ha ha! These are my readers. The three times are over the other side. Don't let the magic smoke out. Ah, yeah, there is writing on top of it. ~250 volts. One something. Haha. Let's get some smarts on here. Take a picture and blow up the picture. Ba, 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 bum, bum, bum. Breathe it in. Two pins. It has two pins. No, you stupid thing. Keep your focus. Is that good enough? Yeah, I think that's good enough. T, 1 amp, 250 volts. R392. I don't know if you guys can even see that. And my mother is calling me, believe it or not. So yeah. Not 100% sure what that is, but I shall find out in due course. Maybe one of you guys knows. So my mother is, rather strangely, actually calling me for something. So, So I shall have to go and see what Mother Dearest wants. So thanks for joining me, folks. I hope the links and bits and pieces were of interest. And now you're pretty much up to date with what's going on. To summary, there's still stuff outstanding from Fleabay. I've got to wait for that lot to arrive. And the bathroom is still not fixed. I haven't stabilised it yet, which is a bit of a pain, but there you go. So in January, I will be launching on the small solder project kits to get some practice in. Then I'll be doing the Xbox, or at least one of them. Then I'll be moving on to the Walkmans, taking them apart and sorting them out. And hopefully, in between, enjoying the odd game of Minecraft. So, for now, Merry Christmas to everybody, and to all, a good night. Take care of yourselves, and thank you for watching. Bye for now.